So in the last class about technical writing, we discussed about knowing your target audience and written communication. So while writing something, there will be a target audience irrespective of what you are writing, right? If you are for an author, if you are writing a book, means someone has to read, then only the book will have value. That reader is called as target audience. So moving on from that, today we are going to discuss about the relationship between the reader and the writer. So one who is writing is termed as the writer, one who is reading what is written is the reader. So how the relationship should be between those two, we are going to discuss from that perspective, okay? So the reader-writer relationship is intertwined and dependent on each other. That is true actually. So they are dependent. So the writer is dependent on reader, reader is dependent on writer. So writer, how is he dependent? Because if he writes a book having all his effort and put all his effort has been put in, and he writes a good book, means if no one is reading that, means if no one is reading that, means it doesn't have any value. So the writer is dependent on reader. For example, a reader who seeks good information, new information, he waits for the writer to write the book. Okay, that means writer is dependent on reader. So the relationship is intertwined, right? So therefore the relationship is one of the symbiosis, a relationship of mutual benefit or dependence. Okay, so the relationship between a reader and writer is intertwined and they both depend on each other. That is true actually. So sometimes the writer writes for pleasure and hopefully for their readers. However, what the reader takes from a piece of work may not what the author intended. That is true actually, right? So the author writes with the goal of his perspective, but reader, after reading the book or the document, he can take some other point that is not in the control of the writer. That is true actually. So he can take some other point. Okay, so because reader's view is skewed by their own personal experience. That is true. The author cannot control the reader's view. Some might like the book, some might not like the book. It depending upon their reader's personal choices. Okay. So the author has no control over what reader is going to take from the document. Right. So unlike creative writing, since we are dealing with the technical writing, in the first class itself I told you the difference between technical writing, creative writing and academic writing, right? So it is not like a creative writing. Unlike creative writing, wherein the readers need not to be well-defined community, okay? In technical writing, on most occasions, writer know fairly the types of readers whom they are writing, whom the writing is meant to form. Because technical writing is usually, as I told you, it's a technical document like user manual, a software instruction tool, something like that, right? So creative writing are having a well-designed community, but it is the people might be from different backgrounds in creative writing. So for example, you take a newspaper, you cannot define the reader, target audience, right? Anyone can read, student can read, a professor can read, and a farmer can read. See, there is a whole set of community. Now in technical writing, the readers are not like that. You know whom you are going to write. I am working in a software company. I have developed a software. Let us say, let's take this Mendeley software. Okay, Mendeley reference management software. So I am preparing a tutorial for Mendeley software or Koha software. I know whom I am writing for. The students of MLISE or the users of Koha software. So that means I know my target audience very well. In technical writing, that is the advantage you are having. In creative writing and other academic writing, you don't know, you can't clearly define, because the target audience is spread over different communities, right? In technical writings, we fairly know who we are writing to. So Koha manual is not required for farmers, right? Right, that is true. It is only required for librarians or libraries and students, right? So similarly, so in technical writing, the target audience is clear. So based on that, we can write it clearly, right? So when you are knowing the readers, there is more chance of establishing a good relationship. Okay, the writer has more chance of establishing a good relationship. That is true. When you don't know the reader, like in creative writing or in other kinds of writing, the what you say the chances of establishing a good relationship is less when compared to technical writing, because a farmer reads the same content from a different point of view. A student reads the same content in a different point of view. A student might like it, farmer does not like it. That the author cannot control, okay, what the farmer thinks or student thinks. But in technical writing, I know only the MLIS students and only the librarians are going to read this document of Koha manual, right? So if I write it clearly and if everyone understands, if more than 90% of the people understands, that means the relationship between reader and writer is good. That means I am capable of communicating my thoughts of how to install and how to work Koha using the manual in the form of written communication. So readers are able to understand, it is clear and it is simple and it is concise. So the relation, so ultimately the students and the librarians like it. So ultimately they will be keep waiting for my next book on other DSpace or other library related software. Here see, the relationship is established. When you write it, because you know the target audience well, you are thinking from a library science student or librarian point of view. In creative writing, you would not think like that. There is no way you cannot think from the reader's point of view. You can, not to, only to a certain extent. You cannot think from every community point of view. That is very difficult. So that is a distinct advantage of technical writing over other writing. I hope you understand this, okay? See, the case studies or user studies have the case studies or user studies have become an important discipline of intense research in library and information science corresponding to the market and consumer research in business. See, I don't know whether you have heard the term user studies in library. What do you mean by user? Those who are coming and making use of the libraries are users. They are called in different names also, like patrons, clientele, client, readers or whatever it may be, right? Users. So user studies are essential in order to understand the needs and requirement of the user. So these comes under relationship between the librarian and the user. Similarly, the relationship between the reader and writer should be good. So the reader must understand, in technical writing, the reader must understand the writer. The writer must understand the reader's point of view also, then you have to read it. So I am well versed in software doesn't mean I have to use technical language. Okay, because I am teaching to people who don't know how to use that software. For that I have to go step by step. If from the start itself I use some technical, go try install C and then you do a coding and Python, means no one will understand. So first you go to the step by step procedure and see this is what C is all about. Then you have to install this and then you have to type this code. This code is useful for this purpose. If I tell like this, anyone can understand. So that is the art of writing. So not all knowledgeable persons can be good writers. That is true. You might have knowledge, but your communication might be lacking in certain aspect. Your teaching skills may have certain lacking abilities, right? That is important. So the ultimate goal is whatever you are writing, the reader should understand. So you have to write it from a reader's point of view. You think that no one knows anything. I am going to teach from the basics. You have to write from that. Okay. So there is a communication chain. What do you mean by communication chain? The link, interlinking gaps. We saw the overview of communication process, right? It consists of sender, message, receiver, feedback and everything. So there is a chain of communication. So we will see what it all about, right? So, due to different possibilities of producing, processing and exploiting spoken utterances, there exists a tremendous variety in the architecture of so-called communication chain. So, we define communication chain as the connection between the talker and listener via an auditory, visual or an electric channel. Okay. So, the communication chain is the link between the talker and the auditory. In our case, who is the talker? I am talking. So I am the talker. And who is the auditory? Auditory is a listener who is listening to the speech. Okay, that is auditory. So what is the chain here? What is the channel? A computer, internet connection, Google Meet is the channel. So see the communication channel. So if I am writing, if an author writing means the author is the talker, he is writing in the form of a book. The book is the chain, book is the channel, and the reader is reading the book. So here author, book and reader is there. So these three together forms the communication chain. Okay, the thoughts of the author is written in the form of the book, that is the channel. The message is delivered through this channel, that is the book, and then the reader is reading it, the book. Okay, so the communication chain is a link between the author, message, channel and reader. Okay, we know that information generators and users are operating at the two ends of the communication of transfer chain, right? So particularly in technical communication, the generator of a piece of information is also a user at the same time. Okay, that is true actually. So if I am this second point, you please consider, particularly in technical communication, the generator of a piece of information is also a user. What do you mean by that? So I am writing a manual for COHA. That means either I must be a library professional or a computer science professional who is using COHA, then only I can write a manual. Correct. In technical writing is concerned with manuals, instructions, software writing and transcripts, right? So if I am writing a manual for COHA, I must be using COHA, then only I can understand the ins and outs of COHA, merits and disadvantages of COHA, then only I can make my audience clear. So this, if you type like this, you will get this error. If you get this error, don't worry, you can easily rectify it. Unless I don't know the ins and out of the software, without using it, how can I write it? So that is a key point of technical writing. Though I am generating a piece of information through my manual of COHA, but I am also a user at the same time. I am using COHA, then only I can be expert in writing, right? So hence I am playing a dual role, a user as well as a technical writer. The dual role of a generator. Generator means I am generating new information in the form of technical writing by creating a manual, right? User, create a sort of reader-writer relationship. Create a sort of reader-writer relationships that gets in built into the system of technical communication. So actually I am a user and I am also a writer. So I can understand from the reader's point of view. So this is very much essential in creating a relationship between the readers and writer, so that I can think from the reader's point of view. Okay. So in professional communication, there is a pattern of flow of information from the generator to the user. What do you mean by pattern? Means there is a structure. Directly it will not go. In professional communication, there is a pattern, a systematic, okay, structure. So research papers, monograph, treatises, research reports. So if I write a research paper, that means a journal article or something, you cannot directly read it. How you can read it? I have to write my article first and I have to submit it through a journal. The journal will read the content of the paper, and if the content of the paper is of good quality and is of good research, they will publish it. Then they will make it available to the reader. I cannot directly do that. So this is the pattern of flow. This is the standard way of communicating in professional writing. Okay. See the process. Directly I cannot write a paper and put it in the web. That is not the flow. I have to write the paper. I have to identify the journal. And then I have to send it to the journal. The journal will evaluate whether the paper is of good quality or not. If it is good quality, they will publish it. If it is not of good quality, they will reject it. Simple. So they see the pattern of flow, right? So there are referees, journal editors, users in similar other capacities and communication process. So all of these writers get to know their readers, besides fully aware of the purpose for which the readers use their outputs. Hence the reader-writer relationships is established in this system of communication. See, there are editors, reviewers who will review the content of the paper. They will tell you, please change this terminology, please change that. So it will be good. So in that way, they are telling from the point of view that everyone can understand. Already you have established a connection between the reader and writer in way of professional communication using this pattern of flow, right? it is not as explicit as we see them in professional writing. In proposal, it's not as explicit. As explicit means as visible. Explicit in the sense it is visible. In proposal writing, or feasibility report writing, there is exists a relationship between the writer and the persons of the organization whom these documents are written. So when you are writing a proposal, for example, after completing MLIS, you want to do PhD. And the guide is asking you before joining, you need to write a proposal. So you are, in this case, you are the writer. And who is the reader? Guide is going to read it. So you know the reader very well. So the relationship between the, so you know the guide, you know the person very well. Okay, you know the guide very, you know the teacher, professor very well. So he is asking for a professor, he is asking for a proposal, research proposal. And you are going to write a research proposal. You know his area also. For example, he is expertise in information literacy. So you are planning to write a proposal on information literacy. So you know the reader very well. In order to get this confidence, you need to write it very well. So you are reading related to information literacy. You are reading the articles written by that professor to know his writing style. So because you are going to write a proposal for getting admission for PhD, right? So that proposal should be very good. So the who is going to read it? The guide is going to read it first. Unless the guide approves, the professor approves, you will not get admission. So the proposal should be good. So you need to establish a good relationship between the guide by writing a good proposal. So in this case, see the target audience, you know the target audience in proposal writing. Whereas in the journal or professional writing, it is very difficult to establish, right? Because it follows a pattern of communication, okay? Again, I am telling reader-writer relationship is closely connected with each other and always exists between a generator of information and the ultimate user. Whoever is producing the information or writing the information is the generator, whoever using is the user. And in technical writing, we do have a facility to know the readers. Okay. And in technical writing, we have a facility to know the readers. That means we know who the readers are. As I said earlier, in Koha manual, I know I am going to write for MLIS students, right? So I know I have the facility to know the readers. That is the advantage of technical writing over other modes of writing. Fine. So what do you mean by readers' response and feedback? So after you have written, I have written a manual for Koha, and I want to know that whether that manual is useful for the students of library science or the librarians, whether they are capable of installing Koha and using it without any help, any further help. Based on this manual, they need to install it and they need to use it on their own. That is my ultimate aim. If that aim is not served, means there is some deficiency in my technical writing, though the content may be good, but the information might not reach the target audience in a specific way in which I intended. The objective of my writing is, with this help, with this manual, the student should not ask any more help. It should be self-explanatory. Just go to Google, type Koha, download Koha, install, like this. Simple I am saying. So it should be self-explanatory, it should be clear. And still, if they are asking help means, if they are asking doubt means, something is wrong. They are not able to understand. So how do I know that? Unless I ask a response from the students or the reader and their feedback. Okay, that is very important, right? That is very important. So writers may obtain direct response to their research writing to personal interactions and discussions with their peers and conferences, meetings to correspondence, right? So in research writing, In conferences, when you present papers, what do you say? The peers, the professors, or whatever, whoever it may be, they will comment. They will give you a comment on your research. So what methodology used? This methodology is like this, something like this. They will give comments and you will get to know about it, right? You will get to know about whether the research you carried out is good or bad. In technical writing, we need to adopt to some different strategies, right? So these kind of reader-writer contacts among scholars are a normal feature of scholarly communication. Okay, not in technical communication, scholarly communication, research communication, okay? So there are some other modes. There are some other modes for obtaining readers' response and feedback. Book reviews. We discussed about book reviews, right? That is readers' response. Whoever read the books, they will provide. They will provide a review about that. No, this book is not good. This book is good, like that. Review articles, annual reviews, state of the art reports, citation practices. If the document receives more citation, that means the document is something new and it adds some value to the subject. Document delivery system, indexing and abstracting services can provide some insight to the writer to assess the writing of the writers. That is true actually. So in writing situations other than professional writing, there is an implicit understanding of the purpose in writing. In many instances, there is an indirect involvement of the reader in the preparation of a technical documentation. That is true. There is an indirect involvement. Okay. So prior to the process of writing a proposal or anything, prior to the process of writing a proposal feasibility report, the meetings can take place between the writer and user community. For example, let us say you want to do a PhD, and the guide is, the professor is asking that too under a particular professor. That professor is asking you to write a good proposal. So before starting your proposal, you are talking with the guide personally, sir. What am I supposed to write it, and what topic, and what should be the contents? So when you get a clarity about all these things in the meeting, then you will get an idea that where you need to search and how you need to frame the document and how you need to present the various section of the proposals. So without knowing all these things, and if you write it and if it is not in proper structure, automatically it will be rejected, right? So before ensuring that, you need to get a good understanding. Okay, get an idea and how the content should be presented. If introduction is presented in the conclusion section, everything is wrong, right? So you need to talk to the guide and ascertain about the sections and the content to be covered, number of pages, number of words, everything. In research proposal, you should not write for 20 to 30 words. 5 to 6 pages. 20 to 30 pages, sorry. 5 to 6 pages. And you cannot tell the findings also, because you have not yet carried out. You are going to do the research. That means you have to present the possible outcome, not the findings. Findings means what you have found out. Outcome means what you are going to find. So there is a difference. So you must know all these things and you must get a clarity with your professor. Then only you have to start writing. Before all these things, you just start writing means there will be lots of mistakes and errors. Okay. So when you understand this and when you talk with your guide and something, the relationship between the reader, your guide is going to read your proposal, the writer, you, it will be established and it will be good. And after consulting all these points, and if you write a document, definitely it will come out good with minimal mistakes. There will be mistakes, but it will be very minimal. Okay. So there are four typical types of writing situations. So each type of writing has own parameters. They are instructional documents, study reports, promotional materials, script for a video program, like subtitles, right? So we will see what these are. Okay. So instructional documents is giving instructions, kind of instruction. Let it be technical writing, a COHA software manual, or course material, like I'm giving notes, whatever it may be, instruction, are geared towards the user who are unfamiliar with various ways in which they can access documents. These kind of documents include course material for learning, training, operation manuals, literature guides, etc. They have a distinct group of users. Okay, so like I told you, COHA material, COHA course manual, or course material for this particular course, technical writing. So these documents fall in instructional documents. Okay. Course materials are designed for training programs and may be examined at various levels for the purpose for which it has prepared. So reader's reaction to the course materials can be assessed by circulating a questionnaire or something like that, right, at the end of the course. So I am giving course material, I am telling you to learn. In distance education, they will give only the material, right? Hardly they will take any classes, only one or two classes will be there. Other two on the weekends, right? So they are giving only the materials, you have to read on your own. They have given all the materials, and in order to test whether the material is good or not, whether you have to be able to understand or not, they will provide some feedback mechanism by using questionnaires and other, what do you say, other mechanisms. So we will see how to obtain a user reaction. One is questionnaire. You know what is a questionnaire, right? It is used to know the views of a reader for a particular phenomena for the purpose of writing in certain form. So questionnaire is nothing but you are creating a set of questions about that course material, whether the course content covered is good, whether the course content is clearly explained or something like that, or whether the language is understandable. These kind of questions you are asking in the form of a questionnaire. You have typed each and every question. You can either print it and give it to them, or you can even print it in online forms like Google Forms, and you can send it to them by mail, right? A brochure for a product. The writer makes a brochure for a consumer using questions along with the answer for that particular product to determine the quality for the product. For example, if you have used some product means they will give a brochure. Whether are you satisfied with this product? Whether this product lasted long? Are you sure the quality is good? So in that case, they will know that means this product is good, this product is bad. So depending on the questionnaire is a good tool to collect information, right? Performance test. Second is performance test. A writer may be concerned whether readers will be able to follow instruction and perform tasks correctly. That is true actually. If I am writing a Koha manual, I will have certain doubts that whether the students will be able to follow this manual without my help. And after writing all this manual, if they are not able to install means, it will be a waste, right? That means I have not communicated effectively, or the students are not able to understand something. So something is missing there. So in order to assess that, I will conduct a performance test. Like after writing the manual and after you have followed the instruction, I will conduct a test. You have to install Koha independently and I will monitor it. See, I have given the manual to you and you have read the manual, you have tried it yourself, and a test is conducted. Now you have to install Koha in front of me without any flaws, okay? So when you do this correctly, that means my manual, the written, whatever I have written in that document is effective. And if still you are, still you are facing many problems, you do not understand, means you are not able to install properly, means even the basic concepts are not understood, means then there is a flaw in the communication. Okay. So in this way, the performance test can be used to analyze whether the reader has understood the concept of the writer or not. Okay. Protocol analysis. It is a tool for behavioral analysis. It is a tool for what is a behavioral analysis in psychology or something. The study of thinking is made difficult by the fact that many of the relevant stimuli and responses are not apparent. That is true actually. Many of the responses are not apparent. What do you mean by apparent? Apparent is visible. It is not visible actually. Although the use of verbal reports has a long history in psychology, it is only recently that Erickson and Simon's book on verbal reports expedited the conditions under which such reports may be reliable and valid. Okay. So the responses of users are not apparent. We cannot able to make out what they are trying to convey. That means it is not visible. So these protocol analysis is used to analyze the behavior. Simple. See, these type of test requires readers to think aloud or talk aloud. You see, the studies in behavior analysis and cognitive psychology that have talked aloud reporting may be reviewed. Particular methods for collecting verbal reports using talk aloud method as well as discuss alternative to the talk aloud procedure that are effective under different task conditions. Okay, so what do you mean by talk aloud or think aloud? As they read through a document, this is called protocol analysis. It allows the writer or team to record readers' responses everywhere in the document, analyze readers' comments and revise content. That means when you are reading a document, you need to talk aloud. When you are reading a document means, you have to think. The first step, go to Google, I am saying. And then the second step, download Koha, I am saying. So what you are saying is, what when you are reading this as a reader, what you are saying is, go to Google, you have written, sir. But the next point, you have to write, type Koha in Google search engine. You have missed it. You have missed that point. You are directly saying, download Koha means, how will I download? So type Koha in Google as a keyword. That point is missing. First point is go to Google. Second point is download Koha. Download Mendeley. How to download Mendeley? I am just in Google. I cannot download Mendeley. That means something is missing. So you are talking aloud. You are saying that, sir, this point is missing. How to type Mendeley in Google? So you add the step. So based on the reviews of what you are talking aloud, I will modify my documents. Okay. So this kind of analysis called as protocol analysis, right? So next is investigation reports or study. Investigation reports, it is carried out in government institutions or other bodies to solve a problem or to investigate an event or study. In order to investigate an event, like what is the spread of corona in particular region, that is to investigate an event. It will be carried out by government. It is used to take a decision or help or evolve guidelines for the purpose which the study has been made. If the corona spread is very high in particular area, that result will help them to take precautionary measures for that area. So these kind of studies are called as investigation reports or study. Okay. So this kind of study carried out by individual or a team completed within a specific time frame, because you have to come this corona study means you have to complete within this only. You are taking it this for 5 years means what is the use? Unless then everything will be changed, right? And they have to submit. The study will be conducted by an individual or his team. The government will form a team and you have to study this area and tell the report. And the team will submit the report to the government, right? So who is the reader here? The government or the head who is handling the corona issue is the reader here, and the who is conducting the research is the writer here. Okay. So there are meetings also are held to evaluate the progress of the study or investigation to draw appropriate conclusion. For example, while you are doing research, the head will call and how many people you have sampled in this particular area in Chennai, how many people you have taken for sample, like that they will ask. So please increase the sample size so that we will get broader results or something like that. So they will have some periodic meetings. So the writer, the relationship between the writer and reader is visualized. We can see what is the relationship and we can visualize it. So this kind of task is helpful for preparing the final report that could be make more suitable to take correct decision. Here, even the reader and the writer knows what they are going to write, right? So reader is the government. Based on the report given by the writer, it will be helpful for decision. So over the research process, the head will also assist in helping by giving and sharing its inputs so that the process of the relationship between the reader and writer is visualized. That is instructional writing. Promotional materials means you are promoting something. For example, you have started a company or whatever something, or you have started a brand or something, or you want to make people purchase that particular product. So you are giving flyers like this product is good. You are giving flyers like saying the advantages of this product. So that kind of materials are called as promotion. You are promoting the product for the customers to buy it, right? See, it is being sold. Today in the information era, everything is considered as an economic product. It is being sold and bought in the form of books, journals, conference proceedings, patents, standards, databases, indexing, abstracting. Everything you are buying, right? Libraries are buying books, libraries are buying journal databases, everything. So whatever they purchase, they need to promote it to the users. Then only users will know about it, right? If you have purchased a new book, means you have kept in the library without saying to anyone, how will the user come to know this book is available? So after purchasing, you are promoting the new arrivals, right? So in most of the libraries, they will have sticked new arrivals or they will send a circular. That means you are promoting. Those kind of materials are called as promoting in order to maximize the usage, right? So the American Marketing Association, it's kind of a marketing strategy. Promoting is nothing but a marketing strategy to maximize the user. Advertisement is a paid form of non-personal presentation of ideas, goods or services by an identified sponsor. It is promotional and persuasive in nature. Advertisements are important means of communication which demands special skills in conceptualization and in transforming ideas into visuals and write-ups, right? So if you're promoting a particular product or something, you need to be more creative. You need to be more creative about the product, which should be both in visuals as well as in write-ups, right? So the field of information is one of the utility information as a means of enlarging the scope of improving business or creating new knowledge. It needs to be marketed. That is true. Advertisements are promotional materials in marketing information products and services. In library, we market. What do we market? Library is also having promotional strategies. What do we market? Instead of marketing goods, we market information products, information resources and services. What do you mean by information products? The things that produce information. What are the things that produce information? Books, journals, magazines and whatever resource it may be. And the services. See, we are having this service. We are having alerting service. We are having current awareness service. Unless you promote it to the users, they don't know what is the service offered by the library, right? So these are promoting materials. And if you are writing for promoting materials, your writing should be clear. If you are, for example, for new arrivals, you have to clearly present the new arrivals in such a way. For chemistry department, if you are giving new arrivals which are related to biology, means it is not useful. Then there is no writer-reader relationship, right? So for chemistry, you should provide new arrivals related to chemistry books only and chemistry resources only. Then only the relationship will be established and the reader will come to the library. Similarly, the next one is script writing. So see, after every time we are seeing videos in YouTube or something like that, so only the video will be available. So whatever which is spoken in the video, if you are writing subtitles or script for it, transcripts for it, that is known as script for video programs. Let it be a lecture or let it be any movie or something, whatever it may be. If you are preparing subtitles or preparing script for videos based on the audio and based on the context, that is script. That is, there are many companies, they are doing it. They are doing it, and there are many softwares also. Okay, softwares will have its limitations, but manually if you do it, you will get the wordings right, right? Sometimes the audio will take it, audio will have some mistakes in understanding the pronunciation. So when you are doing script writing or video programs, you should ensure that magazines, you should ensure that the ability to concretize ideas and think and choose appropriate visuals are in need for a difficult task. It is actually difficult. According to the context you have to provide, scripting. Writing has to be minimal but most effective to support visuals, and the voice has to be in the background while reading the script, right? So script writing for video programs requires a lot of creativity. So based on this, you need to establish a, so if there is good subtitles provided, anyone can easily understand. If the subtitles are too large and too lengthy, it will be difficult for the reader to follow. So the reader-writer relationships has to be established from the beginning to achieve success in such ventures, right? So this is all about reader writing relationship. So whatever form of document you are writing, let it be instructional, promotional, or script, or whatever it may be, or government reports, the reader writer relationships in different contexts of technical writing as illustrated, right? So the dual roles, what is a dual role? I am a reader as well as a generator, user. In the communication chain have been discussed. So I hope you understand how to establish a connection between the reader and writer. Okay, so I have given a comprehensive view about the relationship between reader and writer through various forms of writing. So this is all about technical writing. Kindly go through this particular source which is used to prepare this presentation, and thank you.